Good afternoon. I'm Andy Bierhals. And first of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Soto and Gutierrez for the opportunity to speak in the Argentinian program here at the Roentgen Ray. So today I'm going to be discussing the aortic valve and aortic root in the postoperative setting. Related to this talk, I do not have any conflicts of interest. So today what I'd like to start off with is reviewing the normal postoperative expected anatomy and findings from aortic root and aortic valvular surgery. And following that, I'm going to round my talk out with some more common postoperative complications that you may encounter in these patients. So let's start off and think about, why is this important that we need to think about the aortic root and aortic valvular repair? As aortic surgery is becoming more and more commonplace, and many times it is often performed in an emergent setting where there's a high risk of mortality, it is necessary to understand what the common findings are or the expected surgical findings are, as well as the complications. So below here, I have images from the same patient, just to show you kind of the progression of what we would expect in a patient who's had an aortic dissection, as we see here, involving the ascending aorta extending into the valve plane. And this is a one-week post-operative study where we see the typical findings of the graft repair. And this is what the graft looks like immediately post-operative. In addition, we have the bioprosthetic aortic valve that was placed at that time, which is what we see here in the operating room or immediately post-operative. So first, I'm going to start off with the expected post-operative findings, and then I'm going to move on to the complications. So the expected findings that we're going to go over is the visual appearance of postoperative pledgets, grafting material, particularly Gore-Tex, coronary artery buttons, and aortic chimney remnants. It's very important to understand what the normal postoperative findings are as to not mischaracterize these imaging findings as complications. So first, I'm going to start off with the postoperative aorta, and I'm going to focus on the aortic pledget. So what a pledget is basically cotton material that is used for suturing, typically in the ascending aorta at the aortotomy site. Typically, it's going to be anterior in the ascending aorta, at least 1 centimeter below the takeoff of the innominate artery. Why this is important is many times these may be misconfused or misconstrued as a pseudoaneurysm on a post-contrast study. This is why in the post-operative state, we want to get a non-contrast examination because these pledgets have high attenuation, as we see here on this non-contrast image, and its correlate on the post-contrast image, not to confuse this with a pseudoaneurysm. So the point to make here is you really need on the postoperative studies to always have a non-contrast component, really to help you look for any postoperative devices or materials such as a pledget, which may be high attenuation. Moving on from the pledget, which is other material which is normal in the postoperative state, is the graft itself. Typically, it's going to be made of Gore-Tex, and it is going to be circumferential, typically 360 degrees around the aorta. On the non-contrast examinations, you don't want to confuse this for an intramural hematoma. It's going to be very well demarcated. It's going to be smooth, and it's going to be high in attenuation. Oftentimes, you're going to have interspersed low attenuation from the wrap itself. On the post-contrast study, again, it's going to look very symmetrical and very well demarcated, unlike an intramural hematoma. In this patient that has had a type A aortic dissection that was repaired, and this is what it looked like immediately post-operative, the high attenuation Gore-Tex graft, and this is what it looks like on a post-contrast study. Again, it might be confused. You do not want to confuse this for an intramural hematoma. Moving on to the another expected post-operative finding, which is the coronary artery button. What these are is when the surgeon reimplants the coronary arteries on an aortic repair, oftentimes they will take a component of the native aorta in this large button, and that is what gets sutured into the Gore-Tex graft itself. Oftentimes when this is done, what you'll end up with is this fluted or funneled appearance to the suture site with the button, that it may be misconstrued as a pseudoaneurysm, but it's going to have a very well demarcated funnel or cone-shaped appearance that's going to go off into the normal coronary arteries. So here are two examples. Here's in this patient, the right coronary artery, and we see this fluted appearance, which is typical of a button. And on the left main coronary artery here, again, this fluted or funneled appearance, which is very typical of a coronary artery button. Now, if you see the button increasing over time, or if you see irregularity or a non-funneled appearance with a focal outpouching, then you may want to think about or consider a pseudoaneurysm. The last last expected finding that you may encounter when you are evaluating post-operative aortic valve or root repair surgeries is an aortic chimney remnant. So what an aortic chimney is many times for coronary artery bypass and for perfusion, the surgeons will sew in a Gore-Tex graft conduit to connect up to the bypass and to the perfusion machine. And when they are done or completed with perfusion, they will staple off the chimney, leaving a small remnant or a bulge of it, of the chimney itself. So for an aortic chimney, which is a normal finding, here we have the same patient over the course of a year. 1 week post-operative, we have a pre and a post-contrast study. We see this focal outpouching at approximately the 7 to 8 o'clock position of the aorta that has this high attenuation near the end of it. Now you might be wanting to call this a pseudoaneurysm, but there are several things that make us think that this is not a pseudoaneurysm. One, it is very well demarcated. It has a wider neck, and it has this high attenuation that looks like a staple line near the end of it. This is a very good look for a chimney remnant. And over time, again, if you are unclear if this is a pseudoaneurysm or a chimney remnant, you can get a repeat examination. Here is this patient 6 months later for a follow-up. It looks exactly the same. You have a wide-necked outpouching with high attenuation, very typical of a chimney remnant. In addition, we see the fluid decreasing around this, which was what would be expected in the normal postoperative course. And then moving forward to 1 year, again, it looks exactly the same, the focal outpouching with the staple line, very typical of a chimney remnant. Again, if it starts increasing or you have an asymmetric bulge, then you might want to consider the development of a pseudoaneurysm. So those are the common post-operative findings that we may encounter. I'm going to switch gears now, and for the next half of my talk, I'm going to discuss the post-operative complications that you might encounter. And you're going to want to really be in tune for these complications, in particular in patients who had undergone emergent aortic root repair. They have a higher percentage or likelihood of both mortality and complications. So what we will review here today is pseudoaneurysms, perivalvular abscess, perivalvular leak, and sternal dehiscence. So what I'm going to start off with is a pseudoaneurysm. So we have this patient here is about 2 weeks post-operative from an aortic valve of repair, and we see this outpouching anteriorly, fairly similar to that chimney remnant we talked about. But to contrast that with the chimney remnant, we see that this has a narrow neck. It comes out and we have an eccentric bulge. In addition, we do not have the high attenuation at the end of it consistent with a staple line. Lastly, we have a large amount of fluid associated with it, as well as sternal widening and gas within the sternal halves. So the sternal widening, gas, and fluid is fairly indicative or may be indicative of sternal dehiscence and infection, which is highly associated with pseudoaneurysms. But the other things about this that make us think about a pseudoaneurysm is it has a narrow neck, it has an indistinct wall, and it is somewhat irregular and not well demarcated. just another image of this same pseudoaneurysm, again, in the sagittal reconstruction. If you're unclear on the transaxials, doing reconstructions may be extremely helpful to evaluate it. And again, we see this very narrow neck with this large outpouching, unlike the chimney remnant, which is very well demarcated and very focal. So this is a very typical appearance of a pseudoaneurysm. In this particular patient, because of the associated gas and fluid, as well as sternal dehiscence, with the infection that was underlying, the decision was made to try to cool the patient off with antibiotics and before they went on for a repair. So about 3 weeks later, the patient came back because they had oozing from their chest wall of blood. They were re-imaged, and we see now that the pseudoaneurysm has markedly increased in size and actually is eroding out through the sternal halves to the skin surface. So in these situations, these pseudoaneurysms are going to increase in size. While they are not very common, only about 5% or 0.5% of the surgical cases, they have a very high mortality rate of up to 50%, and they are associated with deep tissue infection, sternal dehiscence, mediastinitis. Many times, or most commonly, it is going to occur at the aortotomy site. In this case, it actually occurred at the suture site for the aortic valvular replacement, or at the site of a Gore-Tex graft suture. A pseudoaneurysm does involve all three layers, or disruption of all three layers of the wall, and it is a surgical emergency or urgency that needs to be intervened upon. This patient, because they had an infection and were not a candidate for open surgery due to the higher risk of mortality, the cardiology team did place an amplatzer device right here to temporize the pseudoaneurysm. And we see with the amplatzer placement between these two images, the pseudoaneurysm did stop filling with contrast and started to regress. Another example of a pseudoaneurysm is differentiating it from a perivalvular abscess. A perivalvular abscess. So we have on the top here is a pseudoaneurysm. On this non-contrast study, we see this well-demarcated intermediate attenuation collection. While this could represent a perivalvular abscess or fluid collection, if you're unclear if this is in a potential infection or fluid collection, it is very useful to give contrast, as we gave in this case, and there is enhancement to the same degree as the left ventricle and aorta that is very typical of a pseudoaneurysm that is arising in this case from the suture site of the aortic valve replacement. As opposed to a hematoma, postoperative fluid collection, or abscess, where it is not going to enhance, as in this case below, where when contrast is given, we have this ring-enhancing fluid collection in the anterior mediastinum with gas that is very typical of a perivalvular or periaortic abscess and or evolving hematoma. Again, just to reiterate, the pseudoaneurysms, in this case, this is an example of one that occurred at where the grafting material has pulled away or the sutures had dehisced. We have a narrow neck with a ring-enhancing fluid collection that is somewhat amorphous, which is very typical of a pseudoaneurysm. And these are going to enhance to the same degree as the aorta. Switching gears a little bit to sternal dehiscence, you're going to have displacement of the sternal wires, as we see in this case here. Oftentimes, this is going to be seen commonly on the chest radiographs. You're going to have separation of the sternal halves, and the sternal wires are going to pull through the sternal halves, as well as development of fluid and gas, as we see in this case here. The transaxial image, again, just showing gas interspersed between the sternal halves and separation of the sternal halves, as well as fluid consistent with a deep tissue infection. Oftentimes, you want to differentiate this from sternal dehiscence from a mediastinal abscess or aortic abscess. Most often, as we see in this case here, the first sign is going to be early rotation or separation of the sternal wires. We see this inferior wire here that slightly rotates between these two images. And it's very important to always compare to your immediate post-procedural radiograph. This needs to be differentiated from sternal non-union, as we see here, where there is a slight gap, less than 3 millimeters between the sternal halves, but the wire is intact. So as long as your wires are intact and there isn't increase in distance between the sternal halves, it's going to be more typical of a sternal non-union rather than sternal dehiscence. However, if we get progressive widening of the sternal halves or development of gas in between the sternal halves, we worry about sternal dehiscence, as we see in this case here. Over a 3-month period, we increase the gas and the fluid between the sternal halves compatible with an evolving sternal dehiscence and mediastinal abscess. Typically, you're going to see the gas resolve within 2 to 3 weeks and the fluid resolve within 2 to 3 months. Lastly, I'm going to go over a paravalvular leak, which may be associated with a percutaneously placed aortic valve, such as a TAVR, or a surgically placed aortic valve. Typically, it's very helpful to evaluate the replaced aortic valve in the transaxial plane in relation to the valve itself. And what you want to see is you want to see 360 degrees, the valve leaflet touching the aortic valvular annulus with no gaps. If we see at this case here, there is a gap between the annulus and the device itself compatible with a paravalvular leak. And this is secondary in this case to the exuberant calcification of the aortic valvular leaflets, not allowing this percutaneous valve to appropriately seep. On the sagittal plane, you're going to see separation between the device and the annulus, again, compatible with a paravalvular leak. We have this continuation of contrast beyond the level of the device itself. What you want to differentiate these paravalvular leaks from is an annular rupture, migration of the valve itself, left ventricular outflow tract obstruction, and a paravalvular abscess. These can be seen in up to 12% of the post-procedural TAVRs or percutaneous aortic valves. This will decrease on its own over the first year to about 6% prevalence at year one. But remember, those P patients who have persistent paravalvular leaks are at an increased risk of mortality. The risks for paravalvular leaks are going to be associated with calcification, undersizing the device, or underexpansion of the device. What we want to look for, as I've mentioned earlier, is separation of the device from the annulus, so we see contrast interspersed between the two. This is an example of a case with no paravalvular leak here on the top, where we see the device is well expanded and touching the annulus 360 degrees, as opposed to a paravalvular leak where we see separation. There is a higher mortality with a paravalvular leak at about 1% per year as long as it persists. Again, it's very important to understand that pre-procedural planning, especially in the TAVR situation, and documenting any calcifications of the annulus or calcifications of the aortic valve is going to be important for our cardiology and surgical colleagues for them to understand the likelihood of a paravalvular leak. So what we want to see in the normal situation is 360 degrees, the device touching the annulus, as this case here, as opposed to this lower case here where we have a small gap compatible with a paravalvular leak. So I know that was a broad overview of the postoperative aorta. My goal here today was to go over the very common expected findings, such as a chimney aortic remnant, pledgets, what the Gore-Tex graft looks like, as also go over the more common postoperative complications, such as sternal dehiscence, as we see here, where we have separation of the sternal halves with gas interposed between the sternal halves and the sternal wires pulling through the sternal halves. This does have a high associated mortality. In addition, looking at or being able to evaluate and differentiate a pseudoaneurysm from an aortic chimney remnant. A pseudoaneurysm is going to have a very narrow neck. It is going to be ill-defined and expansile as opposed to a chimney remnant, which is going to be very well demarcated and maintain its stability over time. Lastly, more commonly with the percutaneous aortic valves, but also with surgically placed valves, you have may have a paravalvular leak. We want to make sure that we understand what a paravalvular leak looks like. Specifically, we're looking for disruption or a gap between the device itself and the aortic valve annulus. These are the common expected findings as well as common complications. I hope this talk will help you identify these in the future. I'd like to thank you for your time.